Face 2, I tried to rewatch an old Doctor Who, and wow, am I an adult now. I tried to watch that with my new Star Wars Transformers mentality, and it took me a minute, and I felt guilty, but I had to turn it off. Because sometimes things, to your point, they live better in my mind. Knight Rider lives better in my mind. Wonder Woman lives better in my mind. But when you find your first love like that, when you discover Doctor Who, that's where you are. You cannot undo that feeling. And it's an awesome feeling, because if you like it, great. But if you like it and it sticks with you, damn, that's cool. And that's where you go. Now, if you take yourself back and you rewatch the old ones, cool to see where you come from. But there's no right or wrong place to get on and off something, as long as it is worth the journey.
But can I ask you a question? If you're watching Matt Smith, let's say Matt Smith or David Tennant or Paul Giamatti or Christopher Ferguson, are you sitting there going, "Wow, he's not as good as Tom Baker. Like, Tom Baker was so much better than this." Or is it just really like Bill said?
Tom Baker is wrong again.
I know, so is it just an emotional thing? But do you actually compare them in your mind, or is it just this emotional? But it doesn't stop you from liking Tennant or.
But I got something for you, though.
Samantha wants to call.
Yeah. Oh, Samantha. Hey, our panelists in the audience. Yes. I think you could see different doctors in different doctors if you look for it. I do think that every doctor brings something new to the table. But I also think some doctors call back other doctors, at least in my mind.
So you don't see Smith and Tennant as one kind of doctor, different than the other?
No, I think Matt Smith is way different than David Tennant, because I didn't like Matt Smith when he first started.
And this conversation was actually was the one that almost officially killed the movie. Because you have to remember, it was Peter Pan who went back to the office that started the conversation and got to back into the bitch. The challenge of preparing doctors is that you take away the group.
Yeah.
You said, and I think as to the point you're trying to make, I think you're complaining prefer to appreciate. You can appreciate your first doctor. I go back and rewatch original Who sometimes on the net. But that doesn't take away the appreciation I have for where I start. You can appreciate something while respecting, appreciating, and enjoying what I'm happy. I think that conversation is
I do want to get to the question back there, but I just want to say, what if you like
didn't understand what the blank he liked. He liked to drop this show, tried again, and decided he was stupid. But going to the topic is villains. And one of the villains, I'm sorry, villain with quotes, the dogs were these horrible things. And I'm like, it's a salt and pepper shaker with a stick and a ball. That's scary. But they reinvented them in a new one, and all of a sudden I'm like, oh my god, the dogs are awesome.
Oh wait, and they can fly, and those new balls are explosives, and they're badass now. Like, what is happening? But here's the thing, though. It stuck with you. You watched it way back then and kind of dismissed it, but you tuned into it now to see how it evolved.
I did.
And that is the power in Doctor Who. It is the power in science fiction in general. If you can make somebody stick with you, even if you don't like it, it's good. I have this thing about bad guys and characters, too. If you make me hate you on a show, you deserve an Emmy.
Yeah.
Because if I absolutely cannot stand you, you are doing such a good job.
I have an
but I take that to be true, and only because I've never seen Succession. But, and especially in this day in streaming, at least you refound it. And decided to give it a shot. And that's cool. Yes. No non-plant in the audience, right?
We have discussed this, but I don't know if it's in the book we talked about the torture. It started kind of as a villain.
Oh, man, we haven't even talked about Torchwood. Torchwood
doesn't come up much in the book, and also that aspect of Torchwood is before my time, so I don't really know. Torchwood was pretty much on the right side.
Bless you.
With Eccleston.
Yeah.
But Torchwood doesn't come up much in the book. But you know what does come up, now that you mentioned Torchwood, is we didn't talk about this. I think it's actually the best Eccleston episode is the two-parter with Kepler introduces Jack. That chapter will be written by Joseph Dowery, who's an Emmy-winning producer-writer who wrote for 30-something and won an Emmy. I think it's that producer, Pretty Little Liars. So now I don't know what that has to do with 30-something, but in any event, he wrote a chapter in the book about that two-parter, and the villain to him was Jack.
Oh,
Jack.
Yeah.
Jack is what caused everything to go wrong in that episode. But that is a great memory.
That is good.
I want to ask about talk about the Daleks. Now, I'm going to guess that the Daleks don't actually frighten anybody, right? Largely for the reasons that you mentioned. But can you think of Doctor Who episodes or villains where you actually were scared? I mean, we talked about the Whoopi Woman.
Yes. The one that Neil Gaiman wrote with the Cyclops, I was done. Like, anything Neil Gaiman writes is good. But there's one where they were on like the moon or another planet and there was a cyberpunk. I literally had nightmares as an adult. I cannot.
So I was going to say, this is a while ago, but the one episode where there were those weird water zombie things.
Yeah.
that same mentality happen in real life. So.
Oh, yeah. Oh, all the time. Like, throughout history, in mass ways, like, very recently, right?
You said you're making a list of those, and I'm wondering what, like, is the criteria?
No, so we had to make a list of villains in order to put this book together. So that's kind of done. And I was just kind of illustrating, like, how difficult it would be to narrow it down. But we are making a list of companions. And I would Wait, so you're not buying them? Okay, so can you go off that list? This is what we look for. We look for people who had interesting takes on whatever villain they picked. And then, to be honest with you, we couldn't allow certain villains not to be in the book. Like, the Master could not be in the book. Cybermen could not. Tyler's could not. We'd be angels in the silence of the city. I mean, I'm leaving some out, I'm sure. But we kind of, you know, the dogs have been written about 3 million times, and it had to be somebody who, we've got more than one proposal. We did a call for proposals. And we got more than one proposal for the dog, and then dogs, and then you have to want that's going to look at the dogs from a different perspective.
I have one thing, and then there's a young lady in the back who got her hand up. I think that Doctor Who is a very rare thing indeed, where the doctor and their personality is just as interesting as the villain. There are a lot of times where the villain outshines the good guy. Don't get me wrong, if you are a comic book person in this room, I am not trying to offend you. I love me some Batman. Batman is a vigilante. The Joker wins Academy Awards. You feel me? That being said, your doctor, whoever your doctor is, when they stand toe-to-toe with a Davros, a Dalek, a cyber person, or whatever, at least their personality also stands out. And I think that's important to be said. Yes, the young lady back there.
I'm just going to add, not very scary, maybe just a little lovable, but a Sontarian?
The Sontarans?
Sontarans, yes.
Sontaha!
Sontaha!
You're hilarious.
Do you think that they... would or should bring back the Valyard?
I think that I do. I mean, that's more your thing, but I think that was a really interesting. I only read about that storyline. I haven't. But that goes back again to the Doctor being the sort of doppelganger, the shadow self of the Doctor, and I think that's maybe a big part of why that, and also the fact that they've just gotten really dynamic actors to play.
Yeah, they have.
Role. But I think that would be a great idea. Also, on the question of villains, I may have missed this because I tuned out of, like, I mean, I watched every episode with Jody, but I couldn't stand it. And I thought, first of all, they were too earthy. And secondly, one point I do want to make, that on the subject of companions, when Tennant and Rose split, I was like, sobbing. Yeah. When Martha left, I loved Martha, and she's unfairly, I was sobbing. When Donna left, I was really sorry. And when, because I was such a news Amy, Karen Gillan, Amy Pond fan, that was like too much. But, and then Clara, I was like really upset about. But when Graham and Ryan left, and they're like riding that bike, I mean, I couldn't have cared less. I mean, they had no emotional effect on me whatsoever. And I think that that's like a huge failing on Christian Bale's part, because how can you not be emotional? For me, but what I did was I don't remember if they ever. I thought his and her, Jodie's series got off to a good start because I liked that villain in the first episode. Did he ever get back to them? The one that, remember that kind of big, sort of like metallic, if I'm remembering correctly, the big helmeted thing? Yeah, did he ever come back to that?
He did in the.
Yeah.
wasn't that memorable. She won in the end, but it wasn't the same kind of emotion as, you know, quite a lot of the Daleks and Save the Earth.
So is he the first showrunner who didn't create a memorable villain?
Yeah.
Up in modern Europe. And I hate to again offend you, but I
I get it.
It reminded me of that Chibnall's scripts in the series reminded me of 60s Star Trek. And there's just like no excuse in the 2020s to be making 1960s Star Trek when you have already had, you know, like the other Doctor Who's and Breaking Bad and the Sopranos.
Stuff to watch, something yelled louder, and I wanted to watch that. And same genre, like sci-fi or something like that. What's the name of the show with the Rosinante, the
Expanse.
Thank you, The Expanse. You know, stuff like that. So one of these days I will get to it because I am a Doctor Who fan. And I love seeing new generations, and more to the point, I love seeing what somebody evolves into. Because every doctor kind of sort of remembers their past selves and carries something over, but they always carry new stuff. My doctors, yeah, I gotta say, were back in the day with 12-year-old Bill or 9-year-old Bill. Believe me, 9-year-old Bill was a very happy kid watching on a 12-inch screen. So here's my question. If you had to pick a villain, and you had to pick a doctor to go up against that villain, and you had to pick one companion from all of Doctor Who, you had to pick up a companion from Doctor Who, who would it be? Who would be the ultimate death match of Doctor Who? The what? The Master?
Well, which one?
Which Master?
Yeah, which Master against which? Against which Doctor? I like using fake British. I'm so sorry. I'm so, well, I'll say it in my Chicago. I'm sorry. Okay.
I do agree with Missy's Master. I think the Doctor I would love to see up against Missy's Doctor, or Missy's Master, would be the first Doctor.
The first Doctor?
The very first.
With,
because he doesn't quite know his death. And I think Missy would have been able to manipulate that insecurity in that situation.
And the old man.
And he also did the first time with him.
And he doesn't respect women.
Oh, true that. Oh, my God.
Which is why at the time, the doctor, the period of
his life. Was it though? But yes, I understand. I understand. I understand.
And I think a good companion in that case, following up the fact that the doctor doesn't know who he is and doesn't.
Telling everyone, what are you bloody doing? Again, sorry. That's very fascinating.
I think we're almost out of time. I do want to say two things. One is, three of them, for those of you who like science fiction, which I guess is just about everybody here, the three of the best shows I've seen recently, I think, would all be science fiction. One is Severance, one is Station 11, and one is Dead Ringers. So if you haven't seen those and you get a chance to, I would recommend those. The second thing is, it sounds like Donna is a really big favorite here, and somebody mentioned Bill before. Is there any? Who?
Sarah Jane,
of course. Right?
Oliver. Ace. Rose Tyler. This is what's cool about Doctor Who. I know we're winding out about our time. Oh, and you guys that just came in, there's actually going to be a 50-question test on everything that we just talked about. So get your iPads out. Throw them away. This is actually going to be a pen and paper test.
Also, we were earlier got $100 bills.
Lies. You know what? My closing remark is, I love the fact that we are all in this room of different generations talking about the same thing. And no matter who you love, no matter which who you love, which enemy, or which companion, we're all in here for the same thing, baby, and I love it. It's hot. So keep on doing your thing. Good luck storming the castle.